This is the second lecture on the subject marketing management code number BM370 with credits to. In the last lecture we have learned about the introduction of marketing, and today we are going to move one stage ahead where we are going to speak of two important topics on marketing environment and marketing mix. The entire slideshow shall be divided into two parts, where in the first section we are going to speak about the factors which affect the marketing environment of any business, followed by what strategies can be made to react to this marketing environment, typically in the format of the marketing mix, which is the 4 P's. Let's understand the basic concept of this word marketing environment. Anything which is around us, anything which impacts us, anything which affects our business in total or in singularity is something which can be termed as the factors of the marketing environment, typically the forces that directly and indirectly influence an organization's capability to undertake its business is known as the marketing environment. We can also say that these are the trading forces which are operating in the environment, which may or may not be not controlled, which may or may not be directly impacting us, but in some way they will affect our ability to influence, our ability to satisfy the consumer, and therefore they are important. If we divide them, there are two main sections in which marketing environment can be divided. The broad factors are the micro factors and the macro factors. Typically, the micro factors can be divided into two: the controllable, which can be controllable to a larger extent, and these are the ones which are controllable partially. On the other hand, these are the macro environmental factors, which are largely uncontrollable, and the amount of impact that they have on the organization can be of large consequence. Components of marketing environment. When we have just understood that they are largely controllable partially or fully, but these are the internal environmental factors which affects the business's ability or operations from within the organization. These are the factors or the people who are present within the organization. These can be the functional areas as well as the resources that the organization uses in order to contemplate its marketing actions, largely known as the macro environmental factors. The other one is the external environmental factors. These are largely the macro environmental factors, which are the broader forces which shape the character and shape the character of opportunities and threats that the business is likely to face. If you look at this diagram, we have divided this largely into three sections: the center two circles comprising of the micro environment and the outer circle comprising of the macro environment. Here, the micro environment is further divided into two parts: the internal environment, which comprises of the 5 M's. Which are the basic foundation functional factors the organization uses in the form of men, money, machinery, material and minutes. There is the macro environment, which consists of the consumers, the suppliers and the stakeholders in the form of people who are either the board of management or the founders of the organization or the leaders of the organization. And the broad macro environment, which comprises of the political factors, technological factors, economical factors and socio-cultural factors. Let us take a look at these in more detail. But before we go any further, as I just mentioned, that all the factors that are internal to the organization are known as the internal environment. They are generally audited by applying the 5 M's, which are the men, material, machine, money, market and materials. The internal environment is as important for managing change as well as the external environment, and therefore the marketers call the process of managing the internal change as internal marketing. These are the broad macro environmental factors in the form of going clockwise, it's the company, the suppliers, the intermediaries, customers, competitors and the marketing mix. This is typically the second part of our slideshow where we are going to speak about how marketing mix largely impacts the organization's ability to serve its customer. Let's talk about the very first one. The forces which are close to the company and they have the ability to affect its business even at a short notice are the micro environmental factors. They comprise of all those organizational and individual activities who directly affect the company. All factors which impact directly on a firm and its activity in relation to a particular market are thus referred to as the micro environment. The first one in this category are the suppliers. They can be the individuals or they can be the business houses. They provide resources which are needed by the company to complete their actions. Thus, a company should always look forward to having good and congenial relations with the suppliers so that there are never any bottlenecks or any failures on the side of the supplier to supply the resources which would be required for the production process. Companies can lower their supply cost and increase product quality to gain competitive advantage in the market. Supply shortages have to be fully monitored and plans should be made to avoid it. The market intermediaries, on the other hand, where suppliers help us in the backward integration, market intermediaries or the distributors help us reach our final consumers. They are either the business houses again, or they can work at, in the form of individual commission agents. They help the company to promote the selling and distribution of their goods towards the end consumers or towards the retailers. They are either the middlemen, the distributing agencies, the market serving agencies, and financial institutions. Anybody who helps a company to reach its end consumers. Customers, yes. A company deals with a large number of variety of customers. They may be in the form of an individual end consumer, say households or individuals like us. They can be in industrial markets, for example, a company selling bricks and cements to industries to build their factories and other things. They can be reseller markets, so where there is a retailer who buys from a wholesaler and then sells it further to the consumers is an example of the reseller market. Then there are government and non-profit markets. So these are the ones who buy largely, in order to produce for the public services. And therefore, the rates at which this goods are to be quoted to them is very different. And finally, international market. So, if there is a company like Reliance who's operating into the market on a full scale, applying or selling its product to each one of these five categories, the marketing strategy has to be, the company has to be very, very alert of any small change that may happen in any one of these five type of customers. Next is the competitors. The second party after the customer who has the high propensity of affecting a company's business's enterprise abilities to serve its customer. No company stands alone in serving and satisfying the needs of the customer market. It always faces competition. This helps the company in facing a host of competitors with confidence. If we say that there is no competition, it is virtually a virtual market, and therefore something such like that does not exist except the Indian Railways. So the company, in order to come out successfully, has to adopt means which may help it to outmaneuver what your competitors are doing. The competitive environment consists of certain basic things which every marketing manager has to take note of. And Philip Kotler has rightly said that the best way for a company to grasp full range of its competition is to take viewpoint of a buyer. So, that's why most of the companies undertake something such as a competitive analysis or a comparative analysis, where they're interested in finding out the consumer's opinion towards them, their products, as well as the competitor's product. What is important here is to gain a competitive edge on your customer, so that you make a product faster than him, better than him, and more qualitative than what he is giving to the customers. The last group of section which affects the micro environment is the general public, the social groups or the community groups. A public can be defined as any group that has an actual or potential interest in or the impact on a company's ability to achieve its objective. The actions of the company do affect the interest of other groups, that is, those who form general public for the company who must be satisfied along with the consumers of the company. According to Kotler, companies must put their primary energy into effectively managing their relationship with their customers. See, it's all about having good relationships with not only the people who are giving you money to run your business, but also that other group of people who are there in the environment, in the form of the society. A company's primary responsibility is to make sure that they are not just working towards customer satisfaction, but they are working towards the social welfare, the entire well-being of the society, so that they are working for the development of the entire community as well. The second group of factors is the macroenvironmental factors. This refers to those factors which are external to a company's activity and do not concern the immediate environment. But these are the ones that affect the business activities in the market, not just yours, but the people around you as well. And therefore, they have the change that they are going to make is going to be larger one in comparison to the microenvironment. These are the broad factors which are included in the macroenvironmental factor. Going clockwise, we have got the demographic factor, economic factors, natural factors, technological factors, political factors, cultural factors. In short, they can be referred to as the forces that shape opportunities and pose threats to any company, and thus are existent in the external environment. These factors are often termed as the PEST analysis. If we see the first four factors is the political factors, P, economical factors, E, social and cultural factors, S, technological factors, T, and then there are others in the form of natural factors and demographic factors as well, commonly known as the PEST analysis. Let's come on to the first one, the political and legal forces. Yes, it includes the laws, the jurisdiction system, the governmental agencies, and pressure groups that influence or limit various organizations and individuals in a given society. If a business is coming in a different country, they naturally have to have complete information and thorough revision of what are the legal procedures, the laws, and the prevailing political scenario in the country in which they are planning to go. In terms of legislation, in terms of governmental agency reinforcements, they also need to have a clear idea of what are the ethical and social social responsible actions in that particular country. For example, when Pizza Hut was coming to India, they were very clear that they had to completely reorganize their cuisines in order to fit the taste buds of the Indian customers. Something such as beef and pork is not welcome here, and therefore they had to eliminate it from their diets. The economical and environmental factors, these are the factors which generally concern things like the country's gross national product, the patterns of the growth of income, the per capita income, income distribution on the basis of various geographical locations, the government and legal restrictions in terms of borrowing and lending of money, and other economic variables like the inflation rate, the interest rates and all. This is important because this in total will determine the consumer's purchasing power and the spending power. And if you are going into a market, naturally you are going with the intention of serving the customers, but there is a basic goal of profit which is there, and it will not come until and unless you are very sure about the economics which are operating in that particular customer belt. The third is the social and cultural forces. I would say that these are the two forces which are perhaps the most important as far as the Indian market is concerned. We are a very ritualistic country. We are a very, sometimes the other countries of the world call us as an conventionalist or an orthodox country. Whatever it is, we still have very strong social and cultural binds, and therefore one needs to acknowledge them when they are planning to come to our country to serve us. Whether it is in terms of, as I've just told you about Pizza Hut, when they were coming here to serve us with the different cuisines that they make, they had to eliminate their basic, very basic stuff that they are operating in, that they are offering in their country. Or whether it is in terms of the punchlines that the company uses, as in the case of Coke, when they came to our country, they still use the punchline Coca-Cola enjoy. But the same punchline may not be acceptable, say, in another Asian country like China, because people there are more orthodox than us, and therefore the company had to change the punchline to Coca-Cola delicious or Coca-Cola happiness, because that is what communicates the ideology better in that country. Demographic factors, perhaps the most basic factors which helps the company to develop an overall idea of how the consumer looks like. In the factors in terms of gender, age, income status, occupation, marital status, personality of the consumer, these are the ones which are included here. This actually talks about the consumer behavior in terms of his temperament, his attitude, his perception, because this has greatest propensity of affecting his business. Very clearly, the male shoes are different from the female shoes, the male clothing is different from the female clothing, the way men wear watches are different. That's the typical criteria that comes here. A marketer must communicate with consumers, anticipate problems, respond to complaints, and make sure that the firm operates properly. The next set of factors is the technological environment. This is the most dramatic force which is now shaping the destiny of the companies. The funny part is it is changing all the more rapidly. It helps us to create new markets and make opportunities. At the same time, it makes the existing products outdated or obsolete. The challenge is to make practical, affordable products. And in this, some of the important issues that the company need to pay attention to is the amount of research costs included, the amount of safety regulations, the amount of time that the company is investing in conceptualizing and flooring the product in front of the consumers. Because the late you would do, the more the chance that the competitor would step in and would snatch away the market from you. So that's the technological environment. National forces, yes. Categorized as the act of God, things like earthquakes, floods, droughts, any such activity which has the influence of affecting your business's operations to the largest, and they are virtually the most non-controllable in the present times. Whatever it is, the businessman has to take care that they utilize the natural resources wisely. They make use of the environmental sustainable strategies so that the businesses will continue to run in the long run, the consumers will continue to get good quality product, and then the quality of life and ecology will be balanced. They should also make sure that they respect the amount of government intervention, that they make sure that the products being made by them are not hazardous in any way, and that they are not causing pollution. That is what is the consideration that the environmental trends require from us. In a nutshell, we can say that it's imperative for a company to scan the external macro environment. in which the firm operates and express this in the terms of the PEST analysis as we have just now seen. The acronym PEST can sometimes be rearranged as STEP, and it was also used to describe the framework for the analysis of these macroenvironmental factors. So we can say that a PEST analysis fits into the overall environmental scan, which includes political, economical, social and technological environment. The second part of this lecture, this interaction, talks of a very important concept in marketing, which is known as marketing mix. When the companies realize that a consumer needs a full-fledged strategy in order to be served well, the companies thought of the various tools or the factors that they could make use of in giving the very best to the customer. It was then that this concept of marketing mix came up. In the very initial time, in one of the papers or articles written by Neil Borden, he mentioned the concept of marketing mix. He said that marketing mix is a balanced composition of several factors which, when put together, will help the company to serve its customers better. Later on, much work was done, but then after a long time, Jerome McCarthy proposed that out of all factors which can be included in marketing mix, there are four P's which form the basis of serving the consumers well. And thus came the concept of four P's. Later, the four P's and the marketing mix were kept together and the four P's were identified. Much later, Robert Lauterbaum also worked on this concept, and he said that a vis-a-vis 4C can also be developed from the consumer's point of view, which will help us develop a better understanding of what all can be done to serve them better. And thus, it resulted like this. The other typical four P's in the form of product, price, place and promotion. And as per Lauterbaum, there are four C's also for which we are going to come in some time. But then we have to understand one thing very clearly. In the very first lecture, we understood that the scope of marketing has enlarged enough. We are not just operating into the manufacturing industry where we are making products for the consumers, but we are also we have also extended our operations to providing services to the consumer in the form of services given by the doctors or the teachers or the advocates. And therefore, what will be sufficient in the form of four P's for the manufacturing industries may not be sufficient for a service industry, because the character of the service industry is different. And therefore, the four P's were extended to seven P's by adding three more P's, and thus the marketing mix which applies to the service industry is also known as the extended marketing mix or the services marketing mix. And therefore, in my coming interaction, I'm going to speak about all the seven P's. So there are the four P's which are known as product, price, place and promotion. If you see the first four, followed by the three P's which apply for the services industry in the form of people, processes and physical evidence. And then I told you that Robert Lauterbaum came up with the concept of several C's which can be seen from the point of view of consumers, and therefore they came the seven C's in the form of a C to match product is commodity, a C to match price is cost, a C to match place is convenience, C to match promotion is communication, a C to match people is in the form of caring, a C in the form of processes is coordinated efforts, and finally a C in the form of physical evidence or is in the form of confirmation. The only difference is that the seven C's have been given from the point of view of the organization or the marketer, whereas the seven C's have been identified from the point of view of the customer. The basic bottom line can be the basic reason or the underlying reason for the companies to use the four P's is to make a balanced use of all the four attributes in order to reach its target market. And thus we say that the genesis of the marketing mix comes from the integral factor like competition that the firms are facing. In order to be better than the competitor, in order to serve the customers better than the competitors, came the concept of marketing mix. In a nutshell, we can say that marketing mix is the total offer to the customer in the form of the right product through the right distribution channel with the right price platform and in the most eye-catching promotions, so that a consumer gets what he or she needs and customer satisfaction results, thereby giving profit to the company, which is the basis for their existence. the 7 P's of marketing mix, which we are going to discuss one by one. Let's start with the first one, price. The most important parameter of a company's marketing strategy, price. The one which is considered to be the only revenue generator for the company. And these are the most possible pricing strategies that the company can use in order to make a market in the market. The first three one being very, very important, and the fourth one being very common. Let's start from here: the scaling strategy, penetration strategy, psychological strategy, cost leader strategy, and loss leader strategy. So there's a skimming strategy, which means to keep the price of the product very high. It looks something like this. The company has the option of keeping its price low and keeping its price high. The company has the option of keeping its quality also low and quality also high. When the company keeps the price low, it is and the quality is also low, the products are said to be the economy products. When the company has got a high price and company has a high quality, they are known as premium products. There are two different strategies. One is when the price is low but the quality is high, that's what is known as penetration. Products which are meant for the masses. For example, the toothpaste that we use, the common toilet soaps that we are using, they are all in the penetration strategy. And then there comes a strategy where the price is high and the quality is relatively lower. By low, I do not mean that we are talking about the cheap quality, but we are talking about relatively low quality, and therefore such strategies are known as skimming. So when the company is coming up with high priced cosmetics into the market, say for example, Dove soap in the category of soaps can be kept here. Again, I'm reminding you that low quality typically does not mean cheap quality here. It just means that the quality is relatively lesser. Okay, but then the price is high in comparison to that. Therefore, it is known as skimming pricing. The company, apart from these four strategies, can use a psychological strategy, which is known as the odd digit pricing. Typically started in India by Bata and also known as Bata pricing. So when a product is priced at ₹99.99, or when you get to buy something online and the price is just ₹3,999, that is typically what is known as psychological pricing. And then there is the most basic one, which is the cost plus pricing, which means that whatever amount you have incorporated in making a product, you add a particular profit margin to it in order to determine what is going to be the price for a product. So if you have if it has costed you ₹100 to make a particular product and you want to earn a 10% profit on it, so you add a 10% on 100%, which is 110 rupees, and therefore the 10 rupees is going to be your profit percent. The second important P here in the analyst product, another important component of marketing strategy. It becomes important more so in today's time, because I told you in my last interaction with you that consumers have become very sophisticated, consumers have become very demanding, consumers have become very smart. If they go into a market and they are buying a pen, they are just not buying a pen which can write, but then they are buying something which looks beautiful in a hand, something which has got an aesthetic value, something which has got a good name, and thus can be projected in front of the people and can be showed off as well. And thus a product in today's time is not just the utility in itself, but it has become a bouquet of lots of things in terms of its design, technology, utility, convenience, the packaging, quality, branding, etc. So if you are buying a phone, you are not just buying a communication tool through which you can speak and hear, but then you want to play games onto it, you want to click pictures with it, you want to listen to songs, you want to access internet, and thus save and download things. A lot of many things are done. And on the top of that, if it has got a good name which you can take with certain pride in front of others, nothing better than that. And if the company, in order to lure you or attract you, is giving certain accessories in the form of, say, earphones, or if the company is giving you your flip cover, you get even more attracted and influenced to buy it. And finally, if the company says that if anything goes wrong, say in 1 year or 2 year of the time you have purchased the product, they are going to replace it, or they are going to give the repairs and maintenance free of cost, anything can push you over that last ring to buy the product. A number of strategies have been used by the company in order to improve and differentiate their products and increase the sales or the target sales by effectively gaining a competitive advantage. Companies are using strategies like extension. So Nestle is one very good example. When they came into the country, they were just making Nescafe coffee, and then later they entered almost into all the markets. So today they are making Nest tea, they are making lemon tea, they are making food products, they are making ketchups, they are making curds and yogurts and all. So they have extended their strategy. They can come into new editions, they can go go into unrelated diversification. Say for example, T-Series, initially when they came to the country, they were just a music making company, but today they are making detergents and surf as well. They are also making, they are also into movie production. That's it. You can change the packaging or you can totally change the technology. As in the case of, you know, when pages came to the market for the first time, they were there only for a very short time of period, and then they became outdated, and then came the cell phones, which were later on replaced by the mobile phones, and today they are replaced by the smartphones. The third piece is the promotion. A number of ways are available to a company to be heard, to be seen, to project themselves in front of the consumers, to let them know that they are also there. And these are some of the modes that are written here. You can take the way of advertising, endorsements, user trials, direct mailing, leaflets, free gifts, joint ventures or any. Largely, you know, there was a time when the companies used just a few of them, and the idea was largely centering around advertising. But today, advertising is just one option and the company has got several others. These are a few that the company largely uses in the form of, let's go clockwise, starting from the first one, advertising. We have got sales promotion, events and experiences, PR and publicity, direct marketing, interactive marketing and personal selling. And when a company uses any one or two or three or all of them together in some proportion, that is what is known as the marketing communication mix. So let's take an example of a company like, say Hero Honda. Okay, so yes, we have seen the advertisements that the company runs. We have seen the advertisements which started from Desh Ki Dhadkan, then Dhak Dhak, and the one Panchi Uda Jaire, which is being seen today. We have also seen, you know, lot many endorsers from common faces to presently Akshay Kumar today. The company does sales promotion where they are giving you short term, you know, free price offers if you buy them on festival times. Events and experiences, the company organizes free checkup camps, the company is organizing, the phase of youth sponsored by Hero Honda. PR and publicity, we see that the company Hero Honda is undertaking lot many efforts to donate for social causes like protecting child and youth and other stuff. Direct marketing, the company has got their own website through which they are they have got their own company outlets through which you can go and get information about the company and buy products, and you know they are just entering into the field where you'll be able to sell your used bikes to them into the reseller market. Interactive marketing, as I was just talking about the projection through internet, where the company is giving the Hero Honda website lets you come and, you know, discuss on platform the virtual platform with the other owners of the Hero Honda bikes or with the specialist in case you have any problem with your bike. And the last one is personal selling. So when you go to a Hero Honda showroom, you naturally meet sales people there who are there personally available to solve your queries. A company which is making use of almost all the factors of this communication mix in order to be heard and seen by the consumers. This is just one example. Think about other companies like Maruti, they do this. Think about Unilever, they are doing this. Sony, they are doing this. So a better way of getting your product to the right consumers is by using this communication mix. The broad idea of using a promotional exercise is this four-pronged strategy. If you see the four initials written in capital AIDA, this is what is known as the IDA model. So the promotions, the basic objective of a promotional exercise is to grab attention, stimulate the interest of the consumer, create the appropriate amount of desire which induces him to take action. So if you see certain advertisements on the television where they are promoting you that you would become fairer or you would become thinner or you would become more intelligent, then certainly the ad attracts your attention. It would stimulate your interest if they would say that if this is going to happen in just say a 7 days or 10 days or 30 days time period. And finally, when they say that right now buying this is at the cheapest possible price available or it is the most cost effective amongst all the competitors, it would generate desire. And finally, they would give you toll free numbers where you can call and get the products delivered at home, and then you can pay on delivery, would generate you taking action. That's what is known as the AIDA model, the IDA model, the simple response model. A consumer's purchase process flows through these four levels, and the promotion strategy helps you to jump from level A to B to C and D, and therefore you shift from attention to interest to desire and then action. The fourth P in this category is the place, the outlet from where a consumer can get access to the product. A number of options are written here. Some of them are the most traditional and some of them are the most recent ones. So there was a time when you wanted to buy something, you had to go to the shop to get the product. Then came the time that there was no need to go to the retailer to buy a product, but you could buy it directly from the company outlet or you could buy it from the wholesaler. Then came the catalog system where there were books with a number of product and their codes, and you could just fill in the form at the end and pay the money along with it and get the product. But then there's today's time where you can get a product directly by logging on onto the internet. So even if in the midnight at 2 o'clock you decide to buy a product, there is no stopping. You can just log on to the website, see the product, see number of products for as many as long as you want, then buy the one that you want, and you still have the option of paying when the product arrives at your doorstep. This is the typical structure of the marketing channels as it looks in India. I've just mentioned the four commonly operated marketing channels in India. The first one, which is known as the zero level marketing channel, where you see that there is a company or the manufacturer and directly there is a consumer. So there is nobody in between. It's a direct relationship between the manufacturer and the customer, also known as the direct marketing channel or the zero level marketing channel. Then when the company realizes that the number of consumers is high enough and therefore they would need more number of servers in order to serve the customers, here comes the concept of introduction of a retailer, and therefore you have a manufacturer and a customer, and in between you have a retailer. This is what is known as a one level channel. Later on, when the company realizes that the number of retailers are also high enough and therefore the company cannot directly supply goods to them, comes the concept of a wholesaler. It's interesting to note that retailer is that one server who's in the closest link with the consumer, and therefore he is that one person who can act as a sensory organ for the company by grasping and passing on information about the consumer. He is the one who is in closest contact with the customer. On the other hand, you see that wholesaler is the one who is being placed nearer to the manufacturer. Therefore, we can say that he is the company's spokesperson. You know, if there is anything that the retailer or the consumer wants to know, the wholesaler can be used here, who will get the information from the company and pass it to the people downstairs. Any changes in the price, any changes in the policy are communicated through him in addition to providing the goods and services to the reseller as well as to the end consumer. And then there comes this fourth one, which is known as the fully loaded channel. In addition to the wholesaler and retailer, you have a fourth person who is known as the jobber. A person who can act as a commission agent, a person who can act as the order taker, a person who can be taken as a self-displayer, or anybody who acts as a linking pin between this wholesaler and the retailer. And therefore the company can have a number of jobbers, not just one. They can have plenty many jobbers who will be serving, say, on a geographical basis, or who will be serving on consumer basis. But then the fourth one is the fully loaded system. It's also interesting to note that less the number of people between the company and the consumer, the more cost effective the product for the consumer. And therefore here the prices would be the lowest in comparison to all the four, and perhaps here the prices would be higher in comparison to all the others. The next P, after speaking about the four traditional P's which applies to the manufacturing industry, we are venturing into learning about the three additional P's which apply to the services industry, or the extended, which are known as the extended marketing mix. Comes the first one, which is known as people, perhaps the most important one as far as the service industry is concerned, because it is here that the actual interpretation that a consumer will take of the company will depend. It comes from the way the employees of the company are, the management of the company idealizes the way the culture propagates within the company, how they take the consumer, how they respect the consumer, how they make the consumer feel important, and finally it's in the form of customer service. Therefore, if you're going to a bank, or if you're going to a doctor, and say a hotel, and if the people there do not care for you, that even if you have come, whether you have been served or not, how much time you have waited, or if there is an emergency and if you go to a doctor, say in the midnight, and the doctor doesn't treat you well, things go wrong here. I've told you before also, when we were talking in our first lecture, that a product and service are very different in the way they provide gratification and satisfaction to the consumer. A product, even if it is not that good, a consumer still has the satisfaction of carrying something back home. But in the case of a service, the amount of dissatisfaction would be very, very high because the consumer has already paid. The product is the good that the consumer is about to enjoy will get finished off very quickly, whether it is a chocolate or say whether it is a newspaper or say you still get to keep something. If you do not like the taste of the chocolate, you'll be able to keep the rest in the refrigerator. If you do not like the if you could not read the newspaper and the day has passed, perhaps you can read it on a second day, or else you can keep the newspaper for being used for other purposes. But then if you were not well and you went to a doctor and the doctor didn't treat you well, you paid the money but you didn't get the satisfaction, and therefore the amount of dissatisfaction is going to be high. What is important here? The company should understand that consumers are the real purpose of the business, and therefore the same ideology should flow in throughout the company, through the thinking of all the people who are connected, whether it is the actual servers or the people who are the founder members or the people who are managing the business. They should be clearly told that consumers are important for us, and therefore it is not just important for the product to be qualitative, but the way they are served, the service should also be of quality. Thus, they should be told that people here represent the business. The image they present is important. They are the first contact with the human beings, and therefore whatever they will do will provide a lasting image that will reflect on the company. Therefore, it becomes all the more important for the company to train and develop their people, their employees related to the products, the services, and give them enough knowledge so that they have almost all the answers when a consumer questions. They should be told that they should be clear with what the mission of the company is, whether it is just earning profit anyhow or whether it is to earn profit by keeping the consumer satisfied. And finally, the staff should represent an open culture, an interactive culture, a compassionate culture with the customers, so that they feel really important to be associated with the company. The second, the next P for the service industry comes in the form of process. Again, it becomes important as far as the service industry is concerned, because today the way things are being done has dramatically changed, as against almost everything being done with the hands almost 20 years back. Today it is possible to have man-less organizations where all the processes have become automatic. So if you talk about a Coke company, out of the 10 operations they do, 9 are 100% computerized. You just need a person to go and put on the button, otherwise everything is done on itself. Most of the time the buzzer is smart enough to shut it off it by itself after the time has passed. So sometimes you do not even need people to put off the button also. But then process in terms of service industry would come in the form of the way things are done. So opening an account 20 years back was perhaps the most tedious exercise. Opening or buying a telephone connection was something which was a Herculean task for the consumers. Today things have become very, very easy. You just need to make a phone call. The sales representative would be at your doorstep along with all the details. They would ask you to be ready with a checklist of the things that they would need from you. Even if you do not have them, they would be ready to collect it from your house the very next day. And in no time, you would be getting the service. So if you want to get an account opened in a particular bank, or if you want to take an insurance policy, or if you want to invest in a particular mutual fund, now you don't even need, if you have a demat account, you can buy and sell shares by yourself or online. So the process of having, and with the introduction of the plastic money, where you can pay bills and you need not to stand in lines. Nobody likes to be queued, nobody wants to stand in queue for long hours and wait, and thus things have become very, very easier. Today the process of paying bills for telephone, for electricity, for cables and all has become easy. You have got recharge cards available, so most of the time you're not even required to go out of the house. That's where the extent of technology has come in, where things have become easier for the customers. The services, the way they are consumed, the service, the way they are being utilized by the consumers have changed and improvised drastically. Finally, let's come on to the last P for the service industry in the form of the physical environment. So typically, you know, since the moment we started talking about the service industry, I've been telling you things like the quality of people, the quality of process, and we have understood one thing that there is in the case of a product, you go to a market, buy a product, and you come back home easily. Whether you are into a, say, you have gone to buy a car, or if you've gone to buy a mobile handset, the amount of time you are there, you are actually busy, looking at your product and trying to compare it with all the others present. But in case of the service industry, where you have gone to a doctor for seeking consultation, and then since your number is not allowed, you are waiting, or where you have gone to a bank to open a bank account, or to, you know, inquire about your bank account statement, and your number has not come and you are still waiting. This physical environment talks about that time, the time which is your waiting time, the time till which you are not being called to be served, and for that time you are waiting in that environment. So how should your physical ambiance be like? How should your the environment where you are sitting be like? That this physical environment talks about that. And I would like to remind you here about Robert Lauterbloom's 7C, where he was talking about something like confirmation. He says that a consumer always seeks confirmation in terms of quality that the company is offering. The quality does not come in the product or the service that the company is giving, but it comes also in the form of the physical ambiance and environment that the company offers, in terms of the place where the consumer is going to meet the server, the comfort that he is going to seek till he is waiting, the facilities in the form of the restrooms or the washrooms, or say basic facilities like ventilation, lighting, fan, etc. The rundown, which is, you know, the smooth movement that a person has to take from the moment he or she enters the service department to the time he exits. And finally, the entire ambiance should be smart, in the form that if a consumer has to wait, there has to be proper seats, sitting area, either in the form of a sofas or say chairs. If a person has to sit down and fill up a form, there should be tables of appropriate height where a person can sit and write down. If it is about a person has to wait for a longer time, basic facilities like drinking water and washrooms should be available, so that a person feels elevated and not distressed for the entire time that he or she has to be waiting. In my opinion, a typical physical environment would affect the mood of the consumer, and therefore the ambiance and the physical presentation is of utmost important. It should be smart and not shabby. It is for the company to decide whether they are going to be, you know, a trendy one, or they are going to be old fashioned, or whether they are going to be a modern one. It also depends on, you know, whether they choose between the lighter shades or the darker shades. It would be, you know, good to fit the purpose. So if you have entered into a mall where you are going to buy groceries, it would be good if you know, music is there and if a lot of noise is there. But then if you are into a bank, it would be good that something like music is not there. It should be peaceful, it should be quiet, so that a person gets to, you know, pay attention to the work that he or she is doing. Of course, the environment should be clean and not dirty. It should be neat. It's the company's own choice to decide on factors like music, but then of course it should not be a smelly place. It should be properly aired so that a person can sit for as long and relax till his chance comes. In my opinion, it would look something like this: a good ambiance that a person can sit and relax. Probably there can be a television, as in the case of many companies who are using or magazines to read. But then it is important to understand that marketing mix is that one weapon that the company uses to answer the environmental calls. So any change in the environment are to be met through this marketing strategy. A marketing strategy typically will depend on what the objectives of the company are, in the form of, are they striving for profit, or are they working for social welfare, or are they working for the consumer satisfaction. It also would come in the form of the product, whether you have a technical product, or whether you have a common man's product, or whether you have a premium product. It would come in the form of the target market that you are serving, whether they are an individual market, or whether they are a governmental market, or whether they are a geographical specific market. Finally, the market structure, the operating forces among the competitors, whether you are facing a pure competition, perfect competition, or a monopolistic competition. how are the consumers behaving in the form of whether they are more stable in the market in comparison to you, or whether they are coming with more guerrilla strategies to strike you, and whether they are always on the front foot or whether they are playing defensive. That will be again global issues like the social factors, the cultural factors, the political environment is going to affect your marketing mix. Your marketing position, of course, if you are in a very safe and comfortable position, nobody would like to buzz from it, but then change is a part of nature and one has to adhere to it. Product portfolio, in terms of how much time your product has taken into the market, whether it has just entered the market, it is a growing market, or is it a mature market, and what is the actual reputation of your product into the market? Is it a star performer, or is it a trouble child for you? One has to understand. In a nutshell, I can say that some of these factors are imposed on you from the outside environment, whereas some other factors are the call of the nature. As a part of business cycle, some things have to change after a certain period of time, and therefore if you prefer to keep your product the way it was 10 years back to today, probably you may be right in your approach, but then the consumer will not want to have a similar product for such a long time, and thus the need of the hour is you have to change to meet with the consumer's requirement, and thus a good product also need to make upgradations and modifications. So is the pricing, so is the placing, and so is the promotion. At this point in time, I can say that place is one of the most important examples where the Indian market was virtually comfortable with the simple brick and mortar shops, and the people were coming to buy products. Looking at the way things have been happening outside India, we also had to adopt digital marketing, and today we are perhaps the fastest developing country in terms of online marketing. We have almost websites where crores of people are trading on daily basis, and therefore I say again that there are certain factors which are going to come as a threat to you, and therefore you would have to change to keep yourself in sync with them, whereas there are certain other factors which you know in commonplace that after a certain point of time will appear, and therefore you should be ready to change with them. In the end, I have added certain references which are going to help you to complete this, to develop a more better understanding of these topics of marketing environment and marketing mix.